I was 17 years old. I had just finished Middletown High School. It was the summer of 65. I was working at Armco Steel during the summer. That was back when we had steel mills in this country and you had jobs, real manufacturing jobs. But in my spare time, my mother gave me a camera for my birthday, which I had asked for. And I went around looking for pictures and stories that I could freelance. And I stumbled across this very cute young rock and roll band, three brothers, age 12, 11, and 6, from Franklin, Ohio, right next to Middletown. And they were playing church socials, other little events around. And they were good. The six-year-old was the drummer. And I mean, you just had to see them. Today, they'd be a great YouTube moment. They'd be all over YouTube now, you know. But back then, I said, wow, you know, these guys are great. So I introduced myself, and I took pictures with my camera, wrote up a story, sent it all to the Cincinnati Enquirer. And a day or so later, they called me up and said, we love it. We're going to use it. We'll pay you $25. $10 for the story and $5 for each of the three pictures they used. And they set up a whole picture page in there. So that was the first money I made in this business. And what was great about that was, you know, here I was 17 years old, and I was an African American at a time when newspapers, TV, mainstream radio were just opening up to black folks. You know, this is the summer of 65. And it was, you know, my parents were very nervous about me getting into this business because it was not one that was welcoming to Negroes, as we called ourselves back then, or colored people, as more often in our household. And I always remember my grandmother saying, son, just prepare yourself, because someday the doors of opportunity will open up, and when they do, you want to be ready to step inside. And little did we know, that very summer, the Watts riots broke out in L.A., and the L.A. Times, biggest paper on the West Coast, didn't have a single reporter of color in the newsroom. Although I think Frank Sotomayor was had begun work there, calling himself Frank Meyer just to pass. He's a, you know, Mexican American, a very prominent gentleman in our business and all. But that's the way things were in those days. If you were a journalist of color, as we'd say today, or a woman, you know, if you're a woman, you got hired, most likely they put you on the woman's page. You know, the great thing about freelancing was I could go out, and it was the story that counted. It was the pictures that counted. It wasn't the color or the person providing it. If you had something that editors wanted to buy, they would buy it. So that was the spirit with which I came into this business, and I still have it. I think journalists, we got to be resourceful. That's really what it's about. I'm endlessly amazed, I'm sure you are too, by how much today's America was redefined during that period. Back there in the 60s and all. And we keep harking back to it all the time now, one way or the other, that we're reminded in today's politics and the kind of polarization that we have today. People ask me, you know, have you ever seen a time, you know, was there ever a time when Americans were this divided? And I said, hey, how about the 60s? You know, when I was in Ohio U from 65 to 69, we had over 400 race riots in this country. You know, documented episodes of civil disturbances, which I'm not sure if it included one that I covered when I was interning at the old Dayton Journal Herald there in Ohio. It was a one broke out at the Montgomery County Fairgrounds back then, and immediately the editors looked around the newsroom. Clarence, their first black staffer was me and a summer intern there. And the Dayton Daily News they hired their first black reporter I think a year earlier. I had a couple of people there, including Paul Delaney, who later went to the New York Times and all. Certainly. Our business is redefined during that period, and very much the rest of the country. We all, and really the world. It's because there were other things that I've learned more about now that were going on, of course, with young people in Europe and the Cultural Revolution in China, and so much was redefined during that period. And we journalists, we definitely cover the we write the first draft of history. We see it happening. I actually chose OU for two big reasons. One was the journalism school, but the other was the Post, because it was down to whether to go to Ohio U or to Ohio State, which at that time was viewed as a leader in J education, I think largely because they were a leader in football. So that gave them they gave them this this aura. But the thing that turned me off was that at Ohio U, Ohio State, the newspaper was a laboratory paper, whereas at Ohio U, it was independent. And this meant the students had more of a responsibility to sink or swim on their own. That really appealed to me. And when I first arrived on campus, I immediately headed over to the Post office and offered my services. Rich Pesson, the editor, then was rather astonished because he said, well, thank you, but you have to come back tomorrow. We're not talking to new staffers until then. So my immediate lesson was, no, don't be too eager, because I was ready to jump right into their editorial news discussions right away. But it was very important for me, though. I say the real important lessons that I learned at Ohio U were that there are stories everywhere, and that we are primarily a service business. That if you are not working for the student newspaper or some other publication, and these days now everybody blogs or something, so you get a chance to actually have an audience out there. And that if you don't have an audience, you don't get as much of a feel for what this business is really all about. And it is about mass communication. It's about providing reliable information and some kind of interesting, enlightening, debatable, worth talking about opinions to the public, and having that kind of a conversation with them. And that was so helpful at Ohio U, because it's a big campus, and you get a kid from a small town at a big university, and you can have a hard time relating to all of this. But when you're a student journalist on campus, you realize that there's 15,000-16,000 stories out here, and that's what your real mission is, find out what those stories are and to tell them and be accountable, because you will be read out in those dormitories and all that, and you're going to get feedback one way or the other.